Welcome to my channel, Malavika's Magic. Today I'll be discussing the basic concepts of communication. Let us start with the definition. According to Newman and Sommer, communication is an exchange of facts, ideas, some opinions or emotions by two or more persons. According to this definition, it is obvious that the presence of two or more persons is required in order to initiate the process of communication. Now, having said this, let us find out what could be the objectives of communication. Objectives are the goals of messages that help us to identify the audience, craft messages, and also evaluate its results. Now, broadly, there are two objectives, primary and secondary. So first, let us start with primary. The first one is to give information. The sender gives information to the receivers so that he is understood and he is accepted for his ideas. The receiver in turn also, you know, gives feedback to the sender. So the sender encourages the receiver interpret the information and provide him with a response. Now, the sender is collecting information or gathering information from the receivers with the hope that he can understand the receivers better. So this is the second objective, primary objective of communication. Now, having said this, let us now move on to the secondary objectives. The secondary objectives actually depend upon the situation or the requirement. So therefore, there could be many secondary objectives depending upon the situation. Now, I'll be discussing only the three major secondary objectives. The first one is to give advice. Advice is kind of suggestion that we give to another person so that they follow a course of action. Now, for example, I can advise my son to drink more water. So I can also advise my son to do more traveling. So now let us go to the second objective, that is motivate. To motivate is to give an incentive to someone so that they are encouraged to go ahead with that particular work or they're encouraged to do something. Now, for example, if I want to develop the reading habit of my child, what I can do is I can gift him a book, a storybook that will instill a desire in him to read the book, and also he'll become enthusiastic in the process, and thus his reading habit could improve. Now, to persuade is the next secondary objective. So persuasion means convince the other person to accept your viewpoint. Now, for example, when we go to the shop to buy a product, most of the time the shopkeeper not only gives us the information about the product, but also shows us the utility of the product. And sometimes he also gives us a proof of the feedback from the customers. And there are times when the shopkeeper, you know, tries to encourage us to or persuade us to buy the product by offering us discounts. And most of the time we find that the shopkeeper always says that he gives a deadline by saying that, you know, the price of the product might increase within a couple of days. So with this kind of urgency that is created to buy the product, the customer, as customers, you know, we can place an order for the product immediately. So having understood the objectives of communication, let us now move on to the hallmarks. So hallmarks are the truths and facts that can be arrived at on the basis of reasoning and discussion. So today I'll be discussing with you the six hallmarks of communication. The first one is one cannot not communicate. Second is communication is interactive. The third one is communication is dynamic. The fourth is communication is contextual. The fifth is communication is grounded in perspective. And the sixth is communication is cyclic. So let us discuss. And the first one is, one cannot not communicate. Usually we believe that communication begins when we use words. But even before we start using words, we communicate with the help of body language. Body language means the body movements, which can comprise of our hand movements, our facial expressions, gestures, our eye movements, the clothes that we wear, and of course, our hairstyle, and even our skin color could also communicate. So let me discuss, you know, certain aspects of body language. So let us start with personal appearance first. It is said that your first opinion is the last opinion. So personal appearance is depend, this opinion is dependent on the clothes that we wear, the hairstyle, how neat is the cloth that we are wearing, how neat we are. So that will indicate how organized we are, and also the accessories that we wear along with the clothes. So, and it is necessary for us to understand the occasion, the setting when we dress ourselves. So when we go for an interview, for example, the setting is the formal setting. So therefore, we have to dress accordingly and we have to use language also accordingly. So now, having said this, let us now go on to the posture. The posture is the way we sit, stand or walk in a particular situation. For example, a person who is addressing the audience for the first time will be definitely nervous, and therefore unknowingly he might be pacing up and down the floor frequently, or he might be fidgeting with his pen. But this may not be the case with a person who is addressing the audience and is comfortable addressing the audience regularly, and so therefore he might be calm and relaxed. Now let us go on to the next aspect, that is vocal quality. Vocal quality is the variations in the sound, or the variations in our utterance. Now this variation, sometimes, you know, there are people are gifted with this variations, but sometimes we need to really work hard on these variations, so that we need to practice and work hard so that, you know, we can reach a particular result. So these variations can indicate again to what extent the person is able to modulate his or her voice, and he's able to express his feelings at the same time. So now we move on to touch. Touch is basically the most important aspect of body language. It is through touch we can identify the actual intention of the person. So a person might appear to be very friendly, but from the touch we can identify whether he has a bad intention or a good intention. So nowadays it has become mandatory for parents to teach their children that you should not rely on the facial expression to judge a person. So when you shake hands, you should be able to identify the intention of the person. Now, with this, let us move on to the next aspect, that is space. The space is the distance between the sender and the receiver, and it all depends upon the relationship between the sender and the receiver. So, for example, if the sender and the receiver, you know, share an intimate relationship, automatically the space between them will be reduced. And this may not be the case when you're meeting a stranger or when you are meeting an unknown people, for example, in a social setting where it is a formal setting. And so therefore the space, you know, is increased between the sender and the receiver. So having understood this, let us now move on to the next postulate. So it is, the next postulate is communication is interactive. So by interactive, I mean that when the sender sends a message to the receiver responds to the message. So therefore it is called as a two-way process. Not only that, the receiver reacts to the message given by the sender. So the receiver has to react, and this reaction could be in the form of verbal as well as non-verbal. So by this, we can say that the sender and the receiver, they are interacting with each other while they are communicating. Now, let us start with the next postulate of communication. That is, communication is dynamic. By dynamic, I mean that is always changing and it's always evolving, and it is important for human beings to adapt to these changes. So it all depends upon human perception, and human perception depends upon certain factors. For example, the technological advancements that are taking place around us, and one needs to adapt ourselves to these technological and changes so that we can use words and we can adjust our choice of words accordingly. Then comes the culture of a particular region. Every region will have their own culture. So one needs to understand the culture before initiating the process of communication. Then comes the space and time. That all regions have a different understanding or different interpretation, and accordingly we should use our words to communicate. Now, let me now tell you of the next postulate of communication, that is communication is contextual. By context, I mean that it refers to the setting in which the communication takes place. The context establishes meaning and can influence what is said and how it is said. It depends upon certain factors, that is the relational, environmental, and cultural context of the region. Now, in fact, it is the receiver and the sender who makes meaning together. The relational context occurs within the context of a relationship, for example, relationship between sender and the receiver of a message and so on. And the cultural context are the rules and patterns of communication that are given by a particular culture and which might differ from the other culture. The environmental factors are basically the external factors that help us to make meaning together. So having understood this, let us now move on to the next postulate, that is communication is grounded in perspective. So every human beings have their own perspective, have their own opinion, or have their own viewpoint, or develop their own viewpoint due to certain factors. For example, this viewpoint could be developed from the experience that they have about the particular region or about people. And this experience is basically arrived at when we communicate with people from that particular region, or when we interact with people. And also when we read about the particular region, or read about a specific area. So from this experience, we gather evidence and then we form our own perspective. So when we are putting forward our own perspective, it is quite natural that we'll talk about this evidence. So sometimes it might result in an argument, because no two people can have the same perspective. A perspective might be similar, but they cannot be same. Now let us move on to the next postulate, that communication is cyclic. By cyclic, I mean that communication takes place between the sender and the receiver. And the sender communicates to the receiver interprets the message and communicates to the sender. And this process continues. So therefore, it is also called as a continuous process. And it is an unending process. It is only when the sender decides to end the process of communication that communication can end. So with this, I would like to end my presentation, and I would thank you all for being patient listeners. I would also like to remind you that in the description box, you can click on the description box, and there is a quiz that I have uploaded. So those who are interested can even attempt the quiz, so that you can find out whether you have understood what I have discussed so far. So having said this, I thank you once again.